Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture series of microprocessor with the subject code KCS 403. This subject is the part of the branch CSE AIML, CS, CSE IT, CSE DS. Mainly computer students are going to study this subject in 4 semester, and EC students will be studying in the 5th semester. So, the first lecture is dedicated to the introduction part and the evolution of microprocessor, that how the microprocessor is the progress in the microprocessor IC is done in the last few years. So, what basically is a microprocessor? Microprocessor, we can split the word into two parts. The first one is micro and the second one is processor. The micro word can be used for the size and as well as for the speed, and the processor means a processor which is able to perform number of tasks, right? So microprocessor is one of the most exciting innovation in electronics since the appearance of the transistor in 1948. So microprocessor is basically a IC, digital IC. It is a digital IC which can be used for multiple programs. It is a clock driven under register based IC, right? So microprocessor, what this statement is meant by, it is a multi programmable, means we can perform n number of operations with the help of microprocessor. It is a clock driven device because we have to synchronize each operation on a same clock pulse, right? Each operation should be synchronized to same clock pulse. Register based, because we are not dealing with a single bit data, we are dealing with multi-bit data. We can have the microprocessor of 4-bit which can handle 4-bit data. We can have the microprocessor of 8-bit which can operate on 8-bit data. Similarly, 16-bit, 32-bit and 64-bit microprocessors are available in nature. And it takes binary data as an input. It processes that data accordingly as per the instructions which are stored in the memory and will provide the result as a output. And it behaves as a central processing unit on a single chip that contains millions and billions of transistors. So I think you must have seen the specifications of your mobile or laptop. You must have seen something that it has this much this kind of processor and this much speed is there, right? So all these things are related to this microprocessor. So the basic components of microprocessor are, it will have ALU, arithmetic and logical unit, register array to store n number of bits, and control unit. And the third important part is control unit. So arithmetic and logical unit, it is a digital circuit present in the microprocessor to perform arithmetic and logical operations, right? All the arithmetic and logical operations on any digital data, on any binary bits, that will be done by ALU. Register array, it is a group of flip-flops, small elements of memory, which is the small element of memory unit, which is used to store data, and it is also used to transfer data and programs that are currently being executed. And control unit, it controls the execution of flow of the data between the microprocessor and the memory and the other peripheral devices, right? So we have one processor, one thing is memory. We can extend our memory. We can write and read and write from that memory, and the external devices, some IO devices, we can also interconnect with the microprocessor. So all the control signals will control the flow of data between this microprocessor, memory and peripheral devices. So this is the basic microprocessor based system. We have the CPU, right? We can have the memory and IO devices, right? Three types of buses will be used in any microprocessor. First one is your data bus, the green one. Then we have the address bus, and then we have the control bus, right? Data bus will be bidirectional because your data will be transmitting from CPU processor to memory or processor to IO input output devices, right? So these data buses are bidirectional. Address buses are unidirectional, and control buses are also bidirectional, because whether we want to write data, whether we want to write take some data from the input devices and we want to display some outputs of output devices. Suppose you have one processor, one microprocessor we have, and one input device. Like keyboard is attached to that. When you press one key, one is pressed on a keyboard, it will be processed by the microprocessor, and microprocessor will display that one on the screen. Display that on the screen. So this way microprocessor will work. So how these microprocessor ICs are built? These ICs are built on a silicon wafer which is made up of silicon. It is then partitioned into n number of small ICs, and then those ICs are placed in the electronic gadgets. Each gadgets we can have the processor. Depending upon, and if we are using that IC for the general purpose, like for all the cars, similar IC will be used, right? When we work for a specific task, for example, we have the washing machine, fully automatic washing machine, or traffic light. There we have the microcontroller. The basic difference between microprocessor and microcontroller is that the microprocessor is a general purpose device. Depending upon the number of address line, it will have that much memory location, and we can externally attach memory location to microprocessor. But in case of microcontroller, that microcontroller is designed for a specific task, and everything, its memory and IO devices, how many IO devices are required, how much memory is required, all those things will be designed on a single IC. So, microprocessor, the word comes from the combination. Till now we have covered this thing. It comes from the word micro and processor. The processor means a device that processes whatever we apply to that. In that context, processor means the device that processes the number, especially in terms of binary, that is logic 0 and logic 1. Now, to process means to manipulate, and we can manipulate the data, we can process the data as per our requirement, whether we want to add two numbers, whether we want to subtract two numbers. So, depending upon the processor capabilities, we can process the data. Now, the microprocessor history and its generation, the very first microprocessor was invented in 1959. The Fairchild Semiconductor, which was founded in 1957, it invented the first IC in 1959. That is the milestone in the microprocessor history. And in 1968, three scientists, Jordan Murray, Robert Noyce, and Andrew Group, they resigned from the Fairchild Semiconductor and started their own company, which is a very famous company named as Intel, and it is Integrated Electronics, which is named as Intel. The Jordan Murray gave one very beautiful law, which is the very basic of VLSI technology, that number of transistors, it is given by Murray's law, known as Murray's law. That number of transistors will be doubled in every 18 months. So Moore's law states that the number of transistor on a small IC, that will be doubled in every 18 months. So, if you have this much size of IC, if initially we have 10 transistors, so after 18 months it will be doubled, right? So, it will be doubled, then 20, then 40, then 80, and so on. So, the exponential on a same size of IC. So, exponential growth of components is seen with the help of this law, right? We can see that. And now how the components are increasing? The components are increasing because we are reducing the size of the component. So that thing is possible with the help of VLSI technology and automation technology, which works beautifully in the generation of this processor. So in 1971, the first microprocessor 4004 was invented. It is a 4-bit microprocessor. A microprocessor is also known as a central processing unit, in which number of peripherals are fabricated on a single chip. It has ALU, control unit, register, and bus system, and they all perform task on depending upon one clock pulse. Now, a bit about the history of the microprocessor. So, the first IC, the first microprocessor, is invented in 1971 by Ted Hoff and Stanley Mazer. It is named as Intel 4004 or 4040 IC. It works on 740 kilohertz, and the number of transistor present in this IC is 2300, and it can process 60,000 instructions per second. This is a picture of 4004 IC and 4040 IC. This 4040 IC is a bit modified version of this 4004 IC. Next, we have the 8-bit processor, and in the series of 8-bit processor, this 8-bit states that we can work on eight bit data. So the first microprocessor in 8-bit series is invented in 1972, and it is 8008 microprocessor, which works on the clock speed of 500 kilohertz. 3500 transistors are there, and it can process 50,000 instructions per second. The second IC is 8080 IC, which works on 2 megahertz. It is invented in 1974. 6000 transistors are there, and it is 10 times faster than 8008 IC. Then the most popular IC which we are going to study in this course is your 8085. It has 16 address lines are there. It is invented in 1976. It works on 3 megahertz frequency, and 6500 transistors are there, and you can see that approximate 8 lakh instructions per second can be processed. So you can see this processor speed, that it is executing 8 lakh instructions per second. So you can see that in this generation, in the series of 8-bit processor, your clock speed is increasing, right? We are increasing the clock speed, and your instructions per second are also increasing, right? And the number of transistors are also increasing. So there is a bit modification in each new IC. Next, in this series, we have the 16-bit processor. The first 16-bit processor is invented in 1978. It is 8086 microprocessor. So it has the ability to multiply and divide directly two numbers. In case of 8085, we don't have the provision to multiply and divide two numbers. We only have the instruction for addition and subtraction. But it doesn't mean that we cannot multiply and divide in 8085. That thing will be done with the successive addition or successive subtraction, right? But in 8086, we have the provision to directly multiply and divide two numbers. 20-bit address line and a 16-bit data line is there, because we have to process 16-bit data. The clock frequency which is used for this processor is 4.77 megahertz, 8 megahertz, and 10 megahertz, depending upon the versions. 29,000 transistors are used, and we can process 2.5 million instructions per second. The another versions are 8088 processor. It is a bit cheaper version of 8086, and it is invented in 1979. It can almost process 2.5 million instruction. Then we have the another processor, that is 80186 and 80187. They have additional components like interrupt controller, clock generator, clock bus controller, and counters. So we have some additional functionality, like how we can process the interrupts, how how many counters we can accommodate. So a bit more modification is given in 80186 processor, and the working speed, working clock frequency is 6 megahertz. Then we have 80286 microprocessor. It is invented in 1982. So it has 16 bit data bus and 24 bit address bus. The clock speed is 8 megahertz, and 134,000 transistors are there, and it can process 4 million instructions per second. So these are the pictorial representation of your 8086 IC, which you will cover in the upcoming lectures. 8088 IC, then we have 80186, another IC, and 80286 IC. Then we have 32-bit processor. Your 32-bit processor will work on 32-bit numbers. So 32-bit data bus will be there. So see, it is written that data bus will be of 32-bit, and it has also address bus which is of 32-bit. So with the help of these 32-bit address lines, 2^32 memory locations we can access. Okay, so address lines will tell you that how many number of locations you are going to access, and data lines they will tell you that how much data you can process on a single instruction, that with the help of single instruction how much bit long data can be processed. So the working clock speed is 16 to 33 megahertz. Then 275,000 transistors are there. Then we have Intel 486 transistor, which is invented in 1986. The clock speed varies from 16 megahertz to 100 megahertz. It has 1.2 million transistors, and it has the capacity to accommodate 8 kilobytes of cache memory. So the extra cache memory is given in this 80486 Intel processor. Next we have Pentium, which is invented in 1993 with a clock speed of 66 megahertz. It has cache memory of 8 bit for the instruction and 8 bit for data. So these are the pictorial representation of 32 bit processor. We have 80386 processor, 80486 processor, Intel Pentium and Intel Pentium Pro. So with the each generation, you can see that this clock frequency speed is increasing, number of transistors are also increasing, and we are have much more modifications in each processor. So in case of 64-bit processor, which comes in picture in 2006, the another versions are Core 2 Dual, and Quad, and Core 2 Extreme. You must have seen these names on the back side of your laptops. You must have seen. You can check that, right? Then we have Intel i3, i5, i7. These comes in picture in came in picture in 2007, 2009, and 2010. They have the different clock speed. So number of transistor, we can see that in case of Core 2, we have 291 million transistors. You can imagine the size of the transistor; it will be very small, and the instruction they have the 64 kilobyte L1 cache per core 4 MB, and for L2 cache. So two cache memories are there. These are the pictorial representation of this 64-bit memory, processor. Then if you go through the generation, you have 8-bit processor. If you start from the generation 8080 IC, then 8086 IC, we have number of bits are increasing and clock speed is also increasing. You can see that clock speed is also increasing. So number of bits are increasing, we are processing more and more number of bits, we are working on more data, right? And number of the frequency is also increasing, so the speed of the processor is also increased. Next, if you go through the technological part, in the first generation we work on PMOS technology. Then their disadvantages will be covered in NMOS technology with all these processors are made up of NMOS technology. Then hybrid MOS, then HCMOS, it's hybrid complementary metal oxide semiconductor, and for fifth generation super scaling processing technology is used. Now generation wise, if you categorize these ICs generation wise, the first generation comes from 1971 to 1972. The era of first generation came which brought the microprocessor like Intel 4004, Rockwell International, and the another examples are PPS 4, Intel 8008. The second generation marked the development of 8-bit microprocessor in 1973 to 1978, and the processor like Intel 8085, Motorola 6800, 6801, they all came in picture in 1973 to 1978. Then the third generation brought forward the 16-bit processor like 8086, 80186, 80286, Motorola 6800, 68010, they all come, and the era for this third generation is 1979 to 1980. They use the HMOS technology. The fourth generation came in picture in 1981 to 1995. They work on 32-bit processor. The 32-bit data will be processed using 32-bit processor. And with the help of HMOS fabrication came into existence, and the Intel 80386, Motorola 68020 are the some popular processors from this generation. Then the fifth generation, from 1995 till now we are working on fifth generation 64-bit processor. On 64-bit processor we are working, and the famous processors are Pentium, dual quad, octa core processor. They all came in picture. So next, microprocessor. These microprocessor can be categorized into, one is depending upon the number of bits they are going to process. Second thing is number of depending upon the instruction set or application. The first one is your CISC, complex instruction set microprocessor. Then we have the reduced instruction set microprocessor. Then super scalar processors. Then application specific integrated circuits. And then digital signal microprocessor. So the first is your complex instruction set microprocessor. The processors are designed to minimize the number of instructions per program and ignore the number of cycles per instruction. See, every instruction when it is executed in microprocessor, in the upcoming lecture you will see that how the instructions are executed. So it will take some clock cycles, right? So this will in CISC processor, the processors are designed to minimize the number of instructions per program, and it will ignore the number of cycles per instruction. The compiler is used to translate high level program to assembly language program because the length of the code is relatively short, and an extra RAM is usually used to store the instruction. And these processors can do tasks like downloading, uploading, and recalling the data from the memory. Apart from these tasks, microprocessor can also handle the complex mathematical operations on a single command. These are a few examples of this microprocessor, that is IBM 370x168, VAX 11x780. Then we have the reduced instruction set microprocessor. These processors are made according to the functions. They are designed to reduce the execution time by using the simplified instruction set. See, now your operation is predefined, and you are only going to use only that much instructions which are necessary to carry out that operation. So number of instructions are now reduced. They can carry out small things in specific commands, and these they can process completely at a faster rate. They require only one clock cycle to implement the result at a uniform execution time, and there is a number of registers and less number of transistors to access the memory location. Load and store instructions are usually used to load the data and to store the data to some another instruction. And these are the examples of this RISC processor. It is our PC 601, 604, 615, 620. Then we have the superscalar microprocessor. Superscalar microprocessor, as their name implies, the processor can perform many many tasks at a same time. They can be used for ALU multipliers like arrays. They have multiple operation units and perform tasks by executing multiple commands. Then we have application specific integrated circuit. They are also known as ASIC, ASIC ICs. They are application specific, and first the specifications are noted down, and then the processor is designed. Lastly, we have the digital signal multiprocessor. These processors are used to convert analog signal to digital signal or digital signal to analog signal. The chips of these processors are used in many devices such as radar, sonar, and home theaters. So, what are the advantages of microprocessor? Microprocessor is a device which has a very high processing speed. Size is very small. It can it doesn't need much maintenance, so easy maintenance. It can perform complex mathematical operations. It is very much flexible, and we can interface that our processor with the external devices also. So it is very much flexible. We can it can be improved according to the requirement. Next, the drawbacks. A few drawbacks will be there. The first, very basic, is the overheating due to the overuse. Performance depend on the size of the data, large board size than microcontroller. And the last one is most microprocessors do not support floating point operation. So what this statement is meant by, they need large board size than microcontroller, because in case of microprocessor is generally denoted by this mu p. On this microprocessor we have this ALU microprocessor thing, and we can externally connect the memory, and we can also connect the IO devices, right? So to accommodate these IO devices in memory, your overall size will be increased. But in case of microcontroller, it's ALU, memory, IO devices, all the things will be fabricated on a single IC. They will be placed on a single board, and so the overall size will be minimized, because this is application specific and this is your general purpose. So as per the requirement, you may have to change the memory size, you may have to change the number of IO devices, right? So depending upon the application, its size will be varied. So there are some basic terms which you will use in this microprocessor. The first is bit. A bit is a digit of binary number which is either 0 or 1. Okay, in 8085 we will be noting down the numbers in zeros and ones. We are going to deal with hexadecimal numbers. So nibble is the combination of 4 bits. So if you have this data 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, this will be your lower nibble. And this will be your higher nibble. Okay. Then the combination of 8 bits, this complete 8 bit is known as 1 byte. Word is given by 16 bits. Double word is given by 32 bit. Data, binary number or code operated by an instruction is known as data. Address, identification of number of memory location is given by address. Clock, all the operation in the microprocessor will be synchronized on this clock pulse. This is the clock pulse. So we have 50% duty cycle. For 50% it will be on, and for 50% it will be off. This complete is known as one clock period. This is high, low. This is known as rise edge, and this is known as low edge, right? The clock is a square wave. The memory capacity is, we write memory capacity as 2 raised to the power n multiply 8. It states that 2 raised to the power address lines into this 8 is your data lines. So memory will be written in this way. For example, you have 1024×8 memory size. So it will be 2^10×8. So 2^10 address lines will be there. 10 address lines will be there and 8 data lines will be there. Right, and with the help of 10 address lines, 1024 memory locations can be accessed. So bus is a group of conducting lines that will carry data, address or control signal. These buses are classified as data buses. First one is your data bus, that is group of conducting line that will carry data. The address bus, a group of conducting line that will carry address. Control bus, a group of conducting line that will carry control signal like read and write signal. CPU bus, a group of conducting line that are directly connected to microprocessor. System buses, a group of conducting line that carries data, address bus, control signal in microprocessor are known as, combination of all these is known as system bus. Okay. So, bus, if you represent anything like this, it means it is working on 1-bit data. If I write it as, I am going to use 8-bit data. Okay, so this is the representation of bits. Then every microprocessor will have ALU, control unit, memory unit, input unit, and output unit. 5 essential components will be there. So depending microprocessor architecture, it will perform number of operation, which will include, it provide the timing and control signal for all the elements of the microprocessor. It will fetch the instruction and data from the memory. It will transfer the data to and from memory and IO devices. It will decode the instruction and perform arithmetic and logical operations that will be done in ALU. And responding to IO generated control signals such as reset and interrupts. All these details we will cover in the upcoming lectures. So, how basically the microprocessor will work? Your 8085 will work in this way. First, it will fetch the instruction. Fetch means to read. It will read the instruction, then it will decode the instruction, it will understand that what it has to perform, and then it will perform the operation which we have to carry out. So, if a question is asked how the microprocessor will work, how the microcomputer will work, it will work in these 3 steps. First, it will fetch, it will read the instruction, it will understand what operation it has to perform, and then the operation will be performed. So, this is all for today's lecture. In the upcoming lecture, we are going to study how the machines read the data, how the machines are going to read the data, because we are talking in English. Machines won't be able to understand the English language, right? Our language. So, we have to deal with the binary codes. So, each instruction is placed in the microprocessor, in the processor, as a mnemonic code, which is known as mnemonic code, and that code will be processed to the processor, and the processor will get to know that what operation we have to perform. So, thank you so much for the today's lecture.
Thank you.